Good morning, Unity North. How about a round of applause for the great music? So, you know, we kind of got used to last Sunday was Easter and it was a full house. It looks a little light today, but I am grateful that you are here today. Yes? Turn to somebody to your left and right and say, I'm grateful you're here today. We are going to start a brand new series today. It's an interfaith series. We celebrated Black History Month in February, then we Women's History Month last month, and now we're going to be starting a whole new series on interfaith exploration. Who here is a bridge builder? All right, we're going to build bridges this whole month, so I hope you're not just here today, but you're here for the whole month. We're going to begin by recognizing that we are all just walking each other home. So if you are so led up on your feet, we're going to get this kicked off and sing together to open up that bridge building exercise. All right, let's sing now. We walk the path of love and the path of grace. Service and the path of faith. We walk the path of spirit, the path of Mother Earth. We walk the path of peace now and a path of rebirth. Let's raise our voices up as we walk all these paths. Everyone is walking home. Everyone is walking home. Everyone is walking home. Everyone is walking home. Everyone is walking. Good. Walk to your left, to your right with a handshake or a hug and say welcome home to somebody. Let them know you are grateful they are here. We're so grateful for those of you who are joining us online. Thank you so much for being a part of the Unity North experience. We are home with you, even though you may be miles away. We hold that connection, we feel that light, and we send love through the airwaves to each and every one of you. All right, Unity North, just come on back. Let's do it from the top.
We walk the path of love and a path of grace. We walk the path of service. We walk the path of spirit, the path of Mother Earth. We walk the path of peace now, and a path of rebirth.
Let's go to the bridge, guys. One, two, three.
As we walk all these paths, we know we're not walking alone. With everybody in every place now.
Let's hear it, Unity.
Yeah, everyone is walking home. Everyone is walking home.
Bring it down now.
Everyone is walking home.
Everybody.
Everyone is walking home.
Give yourselves a round of applause and welcome home to each and every one of you. We're so grateful you are here. So this is the beginning of a whole exploration of interfaith adventures. And so our prayer is going to come from three different traditions today. We're going to begin with my good friend, Iraj Kodadus, who's going to pray, open the service from the Baha'i perspective. And then Dr. Greg Raduca from the Sufi perspective. And then I'll end with a unity prayer, which isn't nearly as poetic, but equally as profound. Take a moment to breathe with us and to open up the space, to open up the altar of our hearts and our spirits to be present to the beauty of this now moment as we begin with these three prayers.
Most of you have this booklet, and on its third page, there's a prayer for humanity that I'm going to share with you. O thou kind Lord, thou hast created all humanity from the same stock. Thou hast decreed that all shall belong to the same household. In thy holy presence, they're all thy servants. and all mankind are sheltered beneath thy tabernacle. All have gathered together in thy table of bounty. All are illumined to the light of thy providence. O God, thou art kind to all, and thou hast provided for all, dost shelter all, conferrest life upon all. Thou hast endowed each and all with talents and faculties, and all are submerged in the ocean of thy mercy. O thou kind Lord, unite all. Let the religions agree and make the nations one so that they may see each other as one family and the whole earth as one home. May they all live together in perfect harmony. O God, raise aloft the banner of the oneness of mankind. O God, establish the most great peace. Cement thou, O God, the hearts together. O thou kind Father God, gladden our hearts through the fragrance of thy love. Brighten our eyes through the light of thy guidance. Delight our ears with the melody of thy word. And shelter us all in the stronghold of thy providence. Thou art the mighty and powerful. Thou art the forgiving. And thou art the one who overlooketh the shortcomings of all mankind.
From the Sufi teacher, Hazrat Inayat Khan, Prayer of Unity. O perfection of love, harmony, and beauty, sustainer of heaven and earth, open our hearts that we may hear thy voice, which constantly cometh from within. Disclose to us your divine light hidden within our souls, that we may know and understand life better. Merciful and compassionate God, give us your great goodness. Teach us your loving forgiveness. Raise us above the distinctions and differences which divide us. Send us the peace of your divine spirit and unite us all in your perfect being. Amen.
Holy infinite presence of goodness and love, you are the breath that we breathe, the heart that beats within our chests, and the very cells within our body. You are the life force, the life sustainer, and the nurturer of every life experience, and we are grateful. We call you forth from the center of our being that we may be focused on the truth that we are never alone, and that we belong to each other. You are with us always and in all ways. Where there is doubt, we will seek and be your comfort. Where there is conflict, we will see and be and access your peace. Where there is confusion, we will know, see, and be your clarity of vision as we move forward with conviction, direction, and love. In the stillness of our souls, we know you as the power to accomplish every dream we have set for ourselves. For you are the energy in every dream, as every dream, as every person. Move through us and as us as we continue to wake up to the oneness, to love, to truth and to peace. In the name of all that is good and holy and sacred and true, we pray. Amen. Amen.
Well, good morning, Bridge Builders. Thank you for that. Those beautiful prayers this morning. What an excellent way to start off our interfaith series this month. And so if it's your first time being here at Unity North and experiencing these different faith traditions, you are in for a treat today. You're in for a treat all month. So as Richard said, come back, because wait, there's more. And we want to acknowledge all of the love and the energy that you are bringing into this room, all of the curiosity and the inquiry that you are bringing into this room as well. So coming forward is our welcome team, and their job is literally to welcome you. They have welcome packets in their hands and a Let's Connect card. Now that Let's Connect card is very special because it's how we stay connected with you. You can fill it out with pen and paper. You can scan the QR code and put it in the basket later, but either way, we want to make sure that we stay connected with you and you know about the many, many amazing things that are happening here at Unity North. So we're going to ask you to raise your hand nice and high in the air so we can get you a welcome packet if it's your first time here. So if it's your first time, let's shine some love on these beautiful souls that are here this morning. Thank you. And we'll keep your hands in the air until we get a welcome packet to you. We're so happy that you chose Unity North this morning. And if it's your first time or first-ish time, first couple of times, we have a welcome table downstairs that you are more than welcome to come to and just meet some new people, have some of your questions answered, and we want to make sure that we stay connected with you and that you know that you are loved, first time today, family here on out. So we have a very special time in our service this morning. And that time is? It's announcement time, of course. What other time could it be? So we have so many things that are coming up in our community. Our first announcement isn't even an event, but it is something special that is going on. We have a raffle for a $5,000 Delta gift card. It does deserve a round of applause. And it's going well, my friends, but it can go even better. And one way that it can go even better is if you share out this announcement on your Facebook page so more people can know. Because yes, you can come down to Holy Grounds after service this Sunday and next Sunday and the Sunday after that to get your tickets. You can also call in the office. But if we are sharing this out with the community, it makes this fundraiser even bigger and even stronger. So that can be a way that you play a role in this raffle. In our next announcement, we have our men's advance coming up, Warriors of the Heart, Taming the Dragons. Amazing, awesome name. So if you are at all curious about that, you want to make sure that you go to the website and check it out, get your tickets. You can go downstairs to Holy Grounds and also ask some questions. There's amazing, beautiful sign down there. You can't miss it. So men's retreat happening on May 4th. And our next announcement, this is another way of giving to this beautiful community. So we know that we can give through offering, through consistent giving, and lots of ways that help to support. And sometimes we want to give and honor someone else. And so we can give in honor of a loved one. That can be in memoriam, it can be someone who's still living, so many different choices. So I suggest you go to the website, unitynorg.org/giving, to find out some more about how you can honor a loved one through giving. And in our next announcement, we are bringing up the lovely Susan Hayden, to talk about the care team. Take it away, Susan.
Hello. Good morning, everyone. Wow, that's very responsive. Post-Easter, thank you. Today, I'm before you because, as many of you know, we have a care team that offers short-term temporary assistance to our spiritual community in time of need. And we find as word spreads about what we do, we're needing more and more volunteers all the time. But I want to return to those three words, our spiritual community, and make those three words up close and personal. Today, each of you walked in here. You smiled at someone. You spoke to someone. you were greeted by an usher, and there was a lot of activity out in our foyer, activity downstairs in our Holy Grounds Cafe. Any one of those individuals tomorrow may call on the care team for assistance. And if you're a care team volunteer, you may provide critical support at a time in someone's life when they are feeling very, very vulnerable. In the words of a volunteer on the care team, who today is also serving as a prayer chaplain, I once asked her her motivation. And she said in her life, for many, many months, she had to depend on others totally and completely for her well-being. Today, she said, she pays it forward. And if paying it forward calls to you, if compassionate service calls to you, please see myself and our new co-lead, Kathleen McKinley, in the foyer after the service. Thank you so much, and we hope to see you all. Thank you.
Thank you, Susan, leading this amazing, necessary team.
And there was one more announcement. As we talked about care and compassion, out in the foyer will also be Misty and Mary with Family Promise. So many different ways to give back, both in our community and outside of our community. So make sure we check out Family Promise and the care team in the foyer after service. Thank you.
So I am delighted. It's been a bit of a hiatus for our guest singer today. Last time we saw her, she looked like she was going to give birth any second here on the stage. And we are proud to say that she has brought her brand new son to be with us today. This is Chelsea Douglas. Well, Grandma, will you hold up Neil, and let's just send some love and blessings to that beautiful baby boy. Chelsea and I talked about what music would be appropriate to start this interfaith exploration, she came up with, well, you're going to know it as soon as you hear it. Sing along with her, but let her heart, her spirit minister to you as well as the words of John Lennon.
Thank you. Good morning, Unity. I'm really happy to be here. You ready? Imagine there's no heaven. It's easy if you try. No hell below us. Above us on the sky. Imagine all the people of mine.
How many dreamers do we have in the room today? Bridge builders, dreamers, visionaries, people who believe in the possibility. That's what we're talking about. And to begin this journey for the month of April, a foundational quote that we're going to use throughout. And by the way, Chelsea, we don't need to say anything, really. You just sing that, and your heart and your soul just filled the room. But we're going to go ahead and talk anyway. We got three guys that like to talk. Here's the, it's from Hans Kung, said, "There will be no peace among the nations without peace among the religions." And then he went on to say, "There will be no peace among the religions without dialogue among the religions." We need to sit down and talk to each other. We need to sit across the table as brothers and sisters, as visionaries, as bridge builders, facing in the direction of what is possible. Yes, imagining a world that can be. This is the month, the basis for the entire month of April, so I hope you will be here for the entire month. I'm here with two of my favorite friends. My friend, Iraj Kodadust, is, we meet at least once a month, sometimes twice a month, to sit across the table and vision the world that is possible. His world is Baha'i, my world is unity, yet we find when we compare notes, we're facing the same direction, and we're sharing the same ideas with different words. Far left is Dr. Greg Raduca, who's a member of Unity North, but also a Sufi, has studied intensively the Sufi tradition. And we're going to share some poetry. We both, all three of us, love poetry and music. And so to start our dialogue, we're going to begin with some poetry and then a song.
This poem from Rumi, the 13th century Persian poet and philosopher, and Sufi. What is to be done, O people? For I do not recognize myself. I'm neither Christian or Jew, Gabr, Hindu, Buddhist, or Muslim. I'm not from the East or from the West. I'm not from the North or from the South. I'm not from this country or that country. I'm not of nature's mint or circling heavens. My place is the placeless. My trace is the traceless. It is neither body or soul, for I belong to the soul of the beloved. I have put duality aside. I have seen that the two worlds are one. One I seek, one I see, one I know, one I call.
From another Sufi poet, Mu'ayyadin ibn al-Arabi, "A garden amidst the flames. Amazing, a garden in the midst of the flames. My heart takes on the form of what it entertains, a meadow for gazelles, a Christian hermitage, a pagan pagoda in the Hajj pilgrimage. It's the writ of the Torah and the Holy Quran. Love's faith is the path I'm meant to travel on. Down whichsoever path love's dromedaries speed. There's my religion. I bless that blessed creed."
Millions of stars placed in the sky by one God. Millions on earth lift up their eyes to one God. So many children looking to God, by many a different name, one Spirit loving each the same. Many the ways all of us pray to one God. Many the paths winding their way to one God. Sisters and brothers, there were no strangers after God's work was done. For your God and my God are one God. Yes, children, your God and my God are one. A Muslim dignitary once confronted Rumi before a large audience, and the critic said, "You claim to be one with 72 religious sects." And he said, "How can that be? The Jews cannot agree with the Christians. The Christians cannot agree with the Muslims, and so on and so forth. If they cannot agree with each other, how can you agree with each of them?" And Rumi thought for a second and said, "Yes, you are right. I agree with you too." Another Rumi story, and then we'll get into our doctrine. Four travelers, a Persian, a Turk, an Arab, and a Greek, were on a journey, and hunger overcame them. They each only had between them, all four, one coin. And they began to passionately argue about how to spend that one coin. Each one wanted to buy grapes, but kept referring to the fruit in their own language, causing a passionate disagreement. They wanted the same thing, yet were using different words to describe it. A linguist happened to be passing by and heard their argument. He understood the problem, and he asked the men to give him the coin so that he could satisfy their hunger and their desires. Taking the coin, the linguist went to a fruit shop, bought four bunches of grapes, and gave one to each of the four men. It was then that the four began to realize and wake up. They were arguing over the same thing, but had been unable to understand the others. Those who seek to understand will find understanding. Those that seek to argue because of language barriers, cultural barriers, and religious barriers will never find understanding. Thus, we kick off a dialogue and we share grapes with the entire universe today. Yes? We're going to take a moment to just lay out the tenets of our various faith traditions. And I invite you to pay careful attention to how the grapes are the grapes are the grapes are the grapes. In the unity tradition, we have five basic unity tenets. The first is there is only one power and one presence. It is good. It is God. Everywhere you look, you see, you feel, you know, and you experience has that spark of God there present. There's not another energy. We got rid of the devil years ago. There's not an energy working against God. It's all the energy of God as love, as peace, and harmony. We're either finding it or we're missing it. We're either awake to it or we're asleep. The second tenet, if there is only one, that means every person on the planet has that spark of divinity within them. It's known by many names. In unity, we call it the Christ. You can call it the Tao, the Atman. You can call it the light. You can call it Fred if you want. But it's the same light that exists at the point of every heart and every soul and every religion. Our third unity tenet is that we use our thoughts, the gifts of God, our ability to think, our feelings, our ability to feel, and our ability to use our body in action. Our thoughts and our feelings and actions are creating the world we live in. We're either in cooperation with truth and oneness, or we're fighting against the current and suffering. So we have been given the gift of thought, feeling, and action to make heaven or hell on earth. Which one are you creating? We are that powerful. The fourth unity tenet, and it's germane to all the religious worlds, all the religious path, meditation and prayer. Get quiet. Get still. Remember the truth of your oneness with God, and then think from that place. Remember your oneness with all creation, all people, and God, and from that place you feel. And then that place you act. And then our fifth unity principle, which is my favorite of the five, because the rest is all theology. Get busy using your body. The truth that you know is the truth that you demonstrate. The truth that you know is the truth that you sit with brothers and sisters and have dialogue and realize we belong to each other. These five principles inform the entire unity doctrine. It is our foundation, and it is important. I'm going to turn the mic over now to my friend Iraj to talk about Baha'ism.
Okay, well, it could be a repeat of some of the things you said, because the tenets, the main tenets of all religions, of all major religions, are fundamentally one and the same. Baha'i faith also starts with the fact that there is one God, the Creator, whose essence is unknowable, but we know him through the attributes, which is all goodness, charity and goodness and kindness and compassion and all the rest. And so if there's one God, and the second one we need to reflect upon, is that he says there's also one religion, which has come through man through time. He calls it progressive revelations. As we develop, as we advance, then God reveals himself again to repeat the same basic tenets, but also to modify those, what he calls social teachings, according to the needs of the time. So there's one God, there's one religion. And so if there's one God and one religion, he says there's also one race, the human race. And ultimately, we have to put aside all these divisions that separates us. Even separation of nations, in the words of Baha'u'llah, the founder of Bahai, this span of the earth is one country and mankind, its citizens. Ultimately, the vision of the Baha'i faith is that the world will become like the United States, which means rather than the middle of last century where the Baha'i faith began, you had the Civil War, all the states fighting one another. They finally came together as one nation. This is the way the world will become. We won't have to spend trillions upon trillions and ammunition. We need to have police force. We need to have governments, but like the states and United States. So that would be the vision of future. So one God, one religion, one humanity. The Baha'i faith began in mid-19th century. And do you know that all religions are waiting for a Messiah? And that was the peak of the time that they're waiting for that Messiah. Hindus called him the return, the coming back of Krishna. Buddhists, coming of fifth Buddha. Zoroastrians, the coming of Shah Bahram. Jews, the coming of the Lord of hosts. Christians, return of Jesus in the glory of the Father. Muslims also are awaiting the return of Jesus, and so on. So all of them are waiting for some kind of return. And Baha'i faith that there's one return, it's all one and the same. And all these denominations, I hear 30,000 in Christianity, 72,000 at least in Islam, and so on, that those are all man-made, and those are not the purpose of religion. Those are this unifying aspects that God himself unifies. And ultimately, if you understand one God, one religion, one humanity, then the promise of Jesus and all these other prophets would be fulfilled. And what is that promise? Peace on earth as it is in heaven.
Let's say that together. Peace on earth as it is in heaven.
Oh, I just want to thank Richard for that very, very beautiful song. And thank Chelsea so much. Wherever John is, I'm sure he loved that version. So thank you. I've been a Sufi since 1972, was initiated into what's called a universal Sufi order. And a universal Sufi order is about what you've heard Richard and Iraj talking about, honoring all paths to God. And it's what, to me, unity is so much about, and that's why I love unity so much. Thich Nhat Hanh talked about the various religions as a fruit salad, and blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, apples, pears, and if you throw away one of those religions, you miss the wonderful, delicious nature of a fruit salad. So, and Thich Nhat Hanh, of course, was a Buddhist. My root teacher is Hazrat Inayat Khan. It's my most important teacher. Brought Sufism to the U.S. first in 1910. And as a universal Sufi, I identify myself as a Christian and a Jew and a Muslim and a Hindu and a Buddhist and the rest that they were talking about. Sufism, particularly in the Middle East, is the mystical form of Islam, which is can be very different from other forms of Islam. And the very last thing that any Sufi would do is participate in an act of terrorism or an act of persecution toward another faith. In fact, one of my Sufi teachers is involved in peace efforts in Palestine and in Israel. A Sufi has been a former Secretary General of the United Nations. And Sufism isn't always necessarily something exotic and out of this world. In fact, Sufis very much are in the world, but not of it. For example, the president of the International Monetary Fund, past president, has been a Sufi. So very, very involved in the goings-on of this world in one guise or another. And you might not ever be able to tell that a person was a Sufi unless you found out about more about that. So Sufis believe that all the major religious paths meet each other at the mountaintop, at the summit. And that's the place where all of the paths disappear into the center of being, which is in all of us and in everything. The Sufis don't have any particular doctrines, don't have any particular dogma. It's all about the experience, and particularly the experience of love and opening the heart. You hear so much in Sufi poetry about love, lover, and beloved. Ishkala mabudlila is how they say it. And it's so much of a path with heart and a path that's walked with love. The lover not only communicates with God, but unites with her, or him, as you will. Sufi honors all great religions of the world, as I mentioned, but they also see the religions as a shade which covers the light that might blind the eyes of souls that are still awakening. In every age, some form of shade or covering of that light has been necessary. And it's also necessary today. The shades of religions may vary in form and color and size, but the light that they cover is always one, without a second, eternal as the heavens, from everlasting to everlasting. And that's one of the things I love about unity so much, is that we emphasize that light. Jesus said, love your friend and even love your enemy. And the Sufi treads that same path in the charity of heart to one's neighbors, as has been said earlier from the podium today in the CARES ministry, in showing love to each other, in showing love to ourselves, which is so very important and that Richard emphasizes time and again. That's what we consider the love of God. There's a story, another Sufi story that I love about the story of the boatman, and some of you may have heard it, where a scholar is taking a boat across a lake, and he's talking to the boatman, and he notices that the boatman is not using the best form of grammar. And so the scholar says, haven't you ever studied grammar? And the boatman says, no. Well, then a quarter of your life has been wasted. And they continue across the lake, and the scholar says, well, have you ever studied Latin? And the boatman says, no. And then the scholar says, well, half your life has been wasted. And then a sudden storm comes up over this huge lake, and the waves really begin to tumble and rock and roll. And so the boatman says, did you ever learn to swim? And the scholar says, no. And he says, well then, all your life has been wasted. So Sufism is about learning to swim.
I just like to add that in order to get to that oneness, what Baha'u'llah, the founder of the Baha'i Faith, instructs, recommends, is first and foremost what he calls independent, unfettered search for truth. Saying that if all of us search for truth, truth in anything is one, we all come to the same conclusion. But in order to search for truth, he says that one of the prerequisites is to understand that science and religion should be in harmony. If you are learning religion in such a way to believe in a lot of unbelievables that I don't need to repeat, those unbelievables were stories. They're not the real truth. So put aside prejudices, superstitions, unfounded dogmas, and the things that science cannot prove, and bring science and religion together, and that will be the beginning of true search for truth, and that will be the beginning of the oneness of humanity.
One of the things that when Iraj and I meet, and it always makes me laugh, they talk about the independent search for truth. You know, Unity students are eternal cynics. They're like, I'm not going to take your word for it. You don't take anybody's word who happens to be up here for it. You go implement the truths in your life and find God for yourself. Find the principles for yourself. That's we think unique to us, but no, it is happening everywhere. We are encouraged by the spiritual leaders to find truth. I'm going to ask a few questions of my colleagues here, but Greg referred to Jesus when he said, love your enemies. And at Unity, we like to carry that a step further, that you have no enemies. We like to take the unconditional love, the vibration of love itself, and to realize that we have no enemies. Yes, certainly in the physical world we do, but when we elevate the vibration to the place of spiritual truth, there are no enemies, and that's what the world needs to save the world. And both the Baha'is and the Sufis have been subjugated, have been put to death for their belief system. Yet, like the Dalai Lama has done and the people of Tibet, that refused to hate the Chinese when they had been driven out of their country. I have found in both the Sufi and the Baha'i tradition that they refuse to have an enemy. They refuse to talk poorly and badly about those who have actually put family members. I know that Iraj has had family members put to death in the name of them following the Baha'i tradition. And so my question to you, to both of you, and to all of us sitting here today, how do you, as a student of spirituality, deal with what the world would call violent and destructive behaviors, especially when it lands on your front door?
First and foremost, we're all responsible for one life and one life only, first and foremost, and that's ourselves. Which means, can I change myself? Through prayers, meditation, godly living, helping others, and not seeing anybody as my enemy. Even as Richard mentioned,
it sounds like unity.
Yes, essence of it is one and the same. Over 20,000 Baha'is so far have been put to death, and thousands upon thousands of them are in jail in Iran, where it started, for promoting these principles. So it starts with ourselves, and if we change ourselves, and if we see that we don't have any enemy, and even those who consider themselves our enemy, they are misguided. We should help them the best we can, even if it means to give up your own life. So that's the path that Baha'i suggests.
With the Sufi, we always look at trying to come to a truce with the war with ourselves, because unless we're dealing with our own shadow, there's a real opportunity or chance to project that shadow onto the world. And so I think it's always important, if you're going to try to make peace in the world, to find peace within oneself. So also the Sufi is very active in the world. As I mentioned, there aren't any, not to put down being a monk or being a nun, that can be very wonderful, but there are no Sufi monks and nuns, and one of the reasons is to be very much in the world but not of it. So Sufis have engaged very actively, and for example, one of the Sufi teachers of mine is engaged in peace efforts in Israel and Palestine right now, trying to seek unity among the three major religions there, and in community dinners and conferences and things like that. It's such a difficult task, and I couldn't begin to imagine what all that would entail being over in that part of the world right now. But it's definitely a seeking of peace between the different religions, which has accounted for so many of the wars. Religions have accounted for so many of the wars over the centuries.
Often we hear in unity, as within, so without. As it is within, it will be in the world. Because as we are thinking and feeling and holding and in the inside, in the level of our soul, it will manifest in the manifest realm, in the world before us. And again, Greg quoted Jesus, in the world, but not of the world. And that's what the Unity student would do. We're having a human experience. We don't deny the human experience. There are things that are difficult, dark, and painful. Yet our job as Unity students is to raise above the human experience, to not be defined by it, to not be defined by the violence, to not be defined by the darkness, understanding and knowing that love is more powerful than the darkness. Love is more powerful. And there are those that would say, you're a Pollyanna. You have to fight fire with fire, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, which leaves us all blind and toothless. Unity says, and isn't it wonderful to hear that we're not the only ones saying that love is more powerful? And I see in my colleagues, in their faith, in their brothers and sisters and their families, that love is still being subjugated, still being put down. But when we join together, we're a stronger force for love's presence on the earth, yes? That I can face my darkness, my individual darkness at the level of my own family when we join together. And where two or more gathered in the name of truth, love will have its way. It's just a matter of the collective raising, the collective vibration of thought when religions come together. People and brothers and sisters come together and we go, we will not waver. We will not waffle from love's presence in the world, knowing with hope. And I have to say, Raj, when we talk some days, it's really hard for me. I look at the news and I'm on my knees going, is there any hope? And my friend, who is several years my senior, is always the banner of hope. Always the one that says, don't give up, because we need each other. We need each other, not only in this room, but we need each other with churches and synagogues and mosques and temples, and the Baha'is meet in homes. We need those homes also as part of the turning this boat around, that love will have its way. And it gives me hope that even in our narrow little field, there are people in their narrow field that are doing the same work, and dialogues are going to bring us together. Can we change the political environment of the country today? You better believe we can. We got to start talking to each other as people of light, as people of love, and as people who are willing to put a hand down and say, we're in this together. My next question for my colleagues is, what does your faith teach about service to humanity? Our fifth unity principle is talk is cheap. What are you doing? What are you doing to make the world a better place? You know, somebody once said, it was a Jewish rabbi, if your church burned down tomorrow, would anybody care outside of your community? And if the answer is no, then you're not doing your work. So what are you doing to push the doors open to the love that we have in this room to be out present with your brothers and your sisters that are in need? So my question is, what does your faith teach about service to the human race?
From the Bahai perspective, if religion is only words, and we go to church and synagogue and sit there, and some of us become monks and spend our time full time, 24 hours a day in those areas, that is not of enough use. We need to go to the world and we need to serve mankind to the best of our abilities, through our profession, through our work, through service, through giving, and compassion. And also, again, one of the principles of the Baha'i faith is finding ways of abolishing extremes of wealth and poverty. From the Baha'i perspective, it's not right for 20, 25 people in this country to sit on trillions or billions, and then we have 40 million people in this country alone who are dying of hunger. So some, not equality, but equity should be created through any means and all means possible.
Yeah, Sufis also believe that service is so central. In Hinduism, it's called karma yoga, and sometimes karma yoga gets a rough rap. Well, it's not as important as Raja yoga and the meditation and all this, but I really do think, and so many Sufis believe also, that service on a day-to-day basis to our fellow man and woman is the most important piece of the spiritual path. If the spiritual path lacks service, then it's, to me, it's really not an authentic spiritual path. The reason that Tibetan Buddhists, for example, get enlightened, and Tibetan Buddhists are teachers to a lot of the Sufi leaders in the United States in particular, if the reason for enlightenment is not better service to others, then it's a really hollow form of enlightenment. So the best motivation for one's own growth is so that one can be more loving of others, be of more service to others.
So the question we ask today, go ahead and applaud. This is good stuff to applaud. What are we doing to make the world heaven on earth? What are we thinking? What are we feeling? And what are we doing to create oneness? We're going to go into a time of meditation now. I had about 5 other questions, but we want to be respectful of your time. These are the kinds of questions we're going to be asking through the whole month of April. And there'll be different people sitting here. Next week, we have a member of the Sikh community. We often say Sikh. It's actually Sikh community. As well as Reverend Avril will be here to represent the Himalayan tradition. But right now, I invite you to put your hand upon your heart and to say these words, many paths, one God. Many people, one light. Many faces, one love. I invite you to take these words of this chant that we often sing here. There is no you, there is no me, there's only God that I can see. There is no us, there is no them. Let this month be a commitment that we make to not just talking about oneness, but breathing it and living it. As the lights come down, I invite you to hold these words as your own, and then we'll have some more prayers. There is no you, there is no me, there's only God that I can see. There is no you, no me, there's only God that I can see. There is no us, there is no them, there's only God, amen. There is no us, no them, there's only God, amen. Let's keep this going from the beginning. There is no you, There is no me. There's only God that I can see. There is no you. There is no me. There's only God that I can see. There is no us. There is no there. There's only God, Amen. There is no us. There is no them. There's only God, Amen. I invite you to close your outer eyes and open the sanctuary of your heart, as once again we have prayers from three traditions.
This short passage is for all of us individually, and then I have a prayer. It's called Prayer for America. There's a lot of hope that the Baha'is placed for America as a symbol of oneness to spread it across the globe. O God, refresh and gladden my spirit. Purify my heart. Illumine my powers. I lay all my affairs in thy hand. Thou art my guide and my refuge. I will no longer be sorrowful and grieved. I'll be a happy and joyful being. O God, I will no longer be full of anxiety, nor will I let trouble harass me. I will not dwell on the unpleasant things of life. O God, thou art more friend to me than unto myself. I dedicate myself to thee, O Lord. And this is the hope for America. O thou kind Lord, this gathering is turning to thee. These hearts are radiant with thy love. These minds and spirit are exhilarated by the message of thy glad tidings. O God, let this American democracy become glorious in its spiritual degrees, even as it has aspired to material degrees, and render this just government victorious. Confirm this revered nation to upraise the standard of the oneness of humanity, to promulgate the most great peace, to become thereby most glorious and praiseworthy among all the nations of the world. O God, this American nation is worthy of thy favors and is deserving of thy mercy. Make it precious and near to thee through thy bounty and bestowal.
A Sufi prayer of guidance. Our most gracious sustainer, Savior of humanity, we greet you with all humility. You are the first cause and the last effect, the divine light and the spirit of guidance, Alpha and Omega, within each one of us. Your light is in all forms, your love in all beings. In a loving mother, in a kind father, in an innocent child, in a helpful friend, in an inspiring teacher. Allow us to recognize you in all your holy names and forms, as Rama, as Krishna, as Shiva, as Buddha. Let us know you as Abraham, as Solomon, Zarathustra, as Moses, as Jesus, as Muhammad, and in many other names and forms, known and unknown to the world. O Messenger of God, you whose heart constantly reaches upward, you come to earth with a message as a dove descending from above when religion decays, speaking the word that fills your mouth as light fills the crescent moon. Let the star of the divine light shining in your heart be reflected in our hearts. May the message of God reach far and wide, illuminating and making the whole of humanity into a single family in the parenthood of God. Amen.
Infinite Spirit of life and light, today we remember that we belong to each other. We commit our every word and deed to the activity of love and oneness. Love and oneness alone. Not a oneness of opinion or expression, but a oneness of spirit, of peace, of love, and of truth. We pray for an end to all violence, to all oppression, and that apathy, indifference, and duality are laid to rest. We pray that prejudice and discrimination give way to understanding, to justice, and to listening. We pray that the hungry are fed, that the homeless are given refuge, and the elderly are revered. We pray that our sacred lands are honored, that Mother Earth is treasured, and that all people cooperate in caring for our common home. We affirm that every culture, race, religion, political party is respected and celebrated for the important place it holds in our nation's fabric. We pray that every woman, every child, every man feels valued, and that every life, no matter its color, shape, or orientation, is seen as a sanctuary of you. We stand in solidarity with those that are dismissed and marginalized, and we stand in compassion for those we do not understand. As a spiritual family, we hold our nation and its leaders in our hearts, that we may continue to be a beacon of hope to those who seek equality, freedom, and opportunity. Let us never forget that in our diversity, we are stronger. We pray that any fear, frustration, or anger that wells up within us inspires us to mend the world and not destroy it. And when we forget these truths, let us have the presence of mind to ask for forgiveness. And when others forget, that forgiveness will be our gift to offer. We affirm that each of us, as spiritual family and community, serve as the vessel and the midwife for these truths. Let's move into the silence and allow the prayers of your own heart, from your own faith tradition, your own spiritual exploration, to live in this room, in this moment, in the silence, in the stillness. There will be no peace among the nations without peace among the religions. And there will be no peace among the religions without dialogue among the religions. Let us be the dreamers, the visionaries, the sharers, the bridge builders at the highest level, the peacemakers at the highest level, the ambassadors and emissaries of God as love at the highest level. And so it is, so it shall be, and so we shall let it be. Aho and amen.
Thank you. Let love have its way. Let love have its way as light in our ushers as they come forward. Let love have its way in our prayer chaplains, Teresa, Juanita, Tara, Vanita, and Jagrati. Thank you for holding sacred space for everyone in the room, for everyone connected with us online. Thank you for the prayers over our prayer box. Thank you all for demonstrating what it looks like when love has its way. And then it's our turn in offering to let love have its way in our giving. And we know there are many ways to give. We can give in the baskets here in service. If you filled out a Let's Connect card earlier, you can put it in these baskets as they come around. We can scan the QR code, go on the website. So many different ways to let our love and our light shine. So in advance of that, we say thank you for our offering. So let's say our offering blessing together. I am so blessed. I am so prosperous, and it is my great pleasure to share of my blessings and to share of my prosperity. And in the giving, the entire world is blessed. Thank you, God. Please join us as we lift our voices in song to sing our offering song together.
Next song that Chelsea's going to sing for us, and I was so thrilled. She always picks the perfect songs. There's nothing that can stop this reality that we have shared today from coming to be, right? There ain't no mountain high enough, there ain't no valley low enough, and there ain't no river wide enough to keep us from experiencing love as the most potent force on the planet. Yes? Please welcome again Chelsea Douglas.
Stand up if you want to. Let's have a good time in here today. Call my name, I'll be there in a hurry. You don't have to worry.
Demonstration of the oneness, a little music underneath and the key, whatever key we're doing the peace song in, but we're not going to do it yet. Final prayers from three traditions. I hope you will come and experience all the different traditions that we celebrate this month. Of closing prayer, Raj.
This is the prayer for unity. Oh my God, oh my God, unite the hearts of thy servants and reveal to them thy great purpose. May they follow thy commandments and abide in thy law. Help them, O God, in their endeavor, and grant them strength to serve thee. O God, leave them not to themselves, but guide their steps by the light of thy knowledge, and cheer their hearts by thy love. Verily, thou art their helper and the Lord.
All I ask of you is forever to remember me as loving you. God is love, lover, and beloved.
And from James Stillett Freeman, the light of God surrounds us, the love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, the presence of God watches over us, but wait, there's more. The mind of God guides us, the life of God flows through us, the laws of God direct us, the peace of God abides within us. The joy of God uplifts us, the strength of God renews us, the beauty of God inspires us. Wherever you are, God is together. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well. Let's end with singing, Let There Be Peace on Earth, and let it begin with you and me.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. Perfect harmony. Let in with me. Let this the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my joyous vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth and let it be. Of God surrounds us. The love of God enfolds us. The power of God protects us. The presence of God watches over us. Wherever
because you were there. Have a fantastic and beautiful week. Please see Chelsea and see that brand new baby and give him a little bit of love. Have a wonderful week. We'll see you next Sunday.